Today, President Trump is suing Facebook, Twitter, and Google over alleged censorship. We'll get into that. And Governor Cuomo issues an executive order declaring a disaster emergency on the issue of gun violence. We've got a lot to come up, and it starts all right now. Welcome to the News and Why It Matters. I'm Sarah Gonzalez, today joined by Jason Buttrell, chief researcher of the Glenn Beck program, and of course, the number one person to give me hell at all points in time. So really glad that Jason is back.
That's the only reason I come into the studio anymore.
He did.
I could do my work from home, but why?
He did wear a polo though, so I can't give him too much. Also joined by Eric July, BlazeTV contributor. So let's talk about President Trump. So President Trump kind of teased that he had a big announcement coming on social media, on the subject of social media. And of course, he announced it today that he will lead a lawsuit, a class action lawsuit over alleged censorship. This is against Twitter, Facebook, and Google, and the CEOs of these companies. And he says he's been censored. I'm not sure that you can argue whether or not he's been censored. I think it is very clear, but let me let President Trump tell you in his own words. Here he is from today. Watch.
I just want to say that I stand before you this morning to announce a very important and very beautiful, I think, development for our freedom and our freedom of speech. And that goes to all Americans. Today, in conjunction with the America First Policy Institute, I'm filing as the lead class representative a major class action lawsuit against the big tech giants, including Facebook, Google, and Twitter, as well as their CEOs, Mark Zuckerberg, Sundar Pichai, and Jack Dorsey. Three real nice guys.
Real nice guys. Three real nice guys. He had to do it, of course, had to slide that in there. Trump said, of course, you know, the social media companies are officially private entities, but in recent years, they have ceased to be private with the enactment and their historical use of Section 230, which obviously we've talked about this on the show many times, protects them from liability. And, you know, remember, he is, of course, in Florida, where Governor DeSantis just recently made it so that people could sue all of these companies. Now we see President Trump doing this. And again, it's class action, but he is the lead plaintiff. I can't wait to hear your thoughts, gentlemen.
This is not easy because the circles I run around with are probably very similar to circles you run around with. And so like the hardcore libertarians would say, this is like any kind of government action that would lead to regulating big tech is absolutely not the way to go. So their perspective is government needs to get all the heck the way out and then let them fend for themselves. I think that's pretty much where I'm at. On the other hand, the language he's using sounds very familiar to me. So he's talking about, he kept saying they're private companies, but they're also acting, like they're public because the government is, involved with them. When he says that, Clarence Thomas just did a ruling that this was also, I think it was about Twitter, about, Trump blocking some Twitter followers. And they did all the way up to the Supreme Court. But Clarence Thomas kind of laid out the framework to where if you want to regulate them, it was just like a footnote in the opinion. But it was, that these big tech companies could be treated as common carriers. So common carriers like railroads, telephone, stuff like that, electric companies, stuff like that, which is, they're supposed to give free access to everyone, regardless. Now, it seemed like he put that in there. So someone high profile like President Trump could take their case and let it go all the way to the Supreme Court. Because the way he worded that, he's basically inviting it in, saying, hey, we'll take it. We'll take it. We'll discuss it. And so this has a very strong possibility to make it up. And you could actually see some government regulation off of this. Now, where I'm on the fence at is, Is that really, if we're going based off of principle alone, on conservative principles, is that really what we should be asking for?
Well, specifically at this point in time, right, under this administration.
Right. Because, you know, if we can take advantage of it, so can they.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Right,
exactly.
Right. Well, that's an interesting point. Thanks for dampening everything. I was getting super pumped up. I do want to add to that, too. The case that Thomas was weighing in on was also completely different, because when you're talking about someone blocking users, like, all you have to do is log out and you can still read that person's tweets, right? That's so much different than not allowing him on any of their platforms at all.
No, it's a good point. And I will say, I want to make the clarification that I do think something needs to be done with these companies.
Right, right. It's either just a slippery slope.
Right, right. They're abusing what they have. Well, I mean, they are a private company. If they want to be abusive, they can do it. It's just like Jim Crow laws, right? So Jim Crow laws, if back in the day when those businesses wanted to be idiots and they wanted to segregate their businesses, go ahead. You know, by all means, do that and miss out on the thousands and millions of dollars that you could have gotten otherwise. The free market should have taken care of that. But the reason it didn't is because government was involved and codifying what they were doing.
Yeah.
That's basically
what we have now.
Yeah. Right. That's basically what we have right now, because government is protecting these companies to segregate off conservative users, or basically anybody they want, they don't want. It's basically the same thing. Mm. Like, that's a better, like, the left likes to talk about Jim Crow laws, and they talk about, this is actually a better comparison
analogy
to that, actually, really.
Yeah, Eric.
See, look, I believe that two things can be true. I say this as a guy that's currently suspended on Twitter, that I'm not fond of, obviously, how a lot of them handle, let's say, their business like this in the way that they do. There's an obvious and clear slant when it comes to who they allow on and who they will not allow on in terms of being egregious on their platform. That's not a secret. We know that it is, no matter how much, know that that's what's happening, no matter how much they like to decline that or rather deflect from it. However, another thing can also be true in that I don't necessarily like the point that he is trying to raise and attempting to basically say, because they benefit from a particular law, this is what Shoshana Wiseman of the R Street Institute was saying, that they can now just wave a magic wand and now say that basically you're deemed as public. Mm-hmm. If that's the route that we want to go, there's a whole host of other things that in which people benefit from, even with direct government subsidies, not loosely calling it a government subsidy, direct government subsidies, that if that's the slope that we want to be on, there's a whole heap of other things and industries that they can declare as public that we don't want. Now, this is my frustration with the Trumps of the world, because they lose sight of that, because I get it. Is it censorship? Yeah. Should it be legal or illegal? That's a completely different conversation. But if you want to make the argument that they are benefiting from, because this is what I will agree with, he said that there are like people that are government actors that are utilizing the Googles of the world in order to basically perpetuate whatever it is that they want to do. And obviously it benefits them from a governmental standpoint. We also know right now, I believe Twitter is going through a spout with India right now in this regards. I believe it's Twitter. It's one of the big tech companies where they're on the verge of basically getting banned from use out there. But if you want to make the case, and this is the case that I have been making, a lot of these guys benefit from world governments. Googles of the world have been doing it forever. Amazons of the world have been doing it for a very, very, very long time. When you considering they've been hosting on their web services, they weren't even profitable until they started taking government contracts. Why can't we rid these companies of that? Not all the time does it appear in a direct government subsidy. Sometimes, though, it's a contract. And I would like to, let's say you talk about them letting them fend for themselves, getting the government all the way out of the way. That's what we would have to do. But that's not what we have right now. Government, be it through campaigning, be it through, again, people that actually work with the government, ad council, whatever, they're literally paying these big companies to advertise on them. That's, I don't know why, if we talk about what's illegal and illegal, illegal and illegal. Why is that right? You know what I mean? That they're basically taking money that is obviously for political gain, and then they're giving it to these private institutions. So while I will agree that there's an issue here, I don't agree with the messaging, or rather the rhetoric that he's utilizing to say that there is something that is there, that is there's some sort of wrongdoing. I think he's losing sight of where the actual wrongdoing is. But that's a slippery slope if we want to sit up here, and it's not a fallacy either. It's a real thing. If we are going to sit up here and say with a wave of a magic wand that just because you benefit from a government law, obviously he's referencing Section 230. If you benefit from a government law, you're no longer public. Well, there's mm-hmm. virtually every single industry. There's people in every single industry yeah. that are doing that. Are we to deem them public as well?
Yeah. Well, and I mean, it is curious too, because I'm a Trump person, right? But it is frustrating because Trump was president, and we had control of everything, and nothing was done. So it just seems to be that there was always a lot of talk, whether it be from the White House or from Congress. Whoever, there was just a lot of tough talk about what we might do if the social media companies make us do it, and then nothing ever really came to fruition.
And your point goes right to the reason why I hate government pretty much completely at all.
Yeah.
Because that's all they do is, yep. you know, they make all these promises, they get into power, and you realize, and that's actually, it's kind of why, like, our government's not perfect, but it's the closest to it, I think, that a lot of people can get to.
And like, they wrote a sternly worded letter and sent it to the manager.
Right.
And that's it
was built because the founders hated it.
Yeah.
So they built the system because it's almost like they were like kind of joking around with each other. Let's have this group, and this group. Let's have three different branches, but let's constantly put them at each other's necks.
Right.
So they never get anything done. They just fight each other the entire time. That's really all it is. So every time you get another administration in, all these promises are typically, they don't deliver on them. You might get an executive order here. You get something lucky or unlucky, like Obamacare, mm-hmm. which is an aberration that, like, that shouldn't even have happened. I don't, Chief Justice Roberts. I actually thank him for that. But yeah, that's why I think that the solution in my mind is, yes, I believe that this is a monster, social media, that's out
Absolutely.
Of control.
Yeah.
But I think what to do is, you know, and the CEOs kind of got together, especially what Dorsey was saying, hey, if you got rid of 230, if the government completely got out, there would be no internet. I'm sorry, you're a gazillionaire. Figure it the heck out.
Yeah.
Figure it the heck out. You can do it.
Someone could.
Yes, you're going to get sued. And maybe this Trump suit starts that off. You know, maybe mm-hmm. all the litigation comes out. Because, you know, once this happens, if this does actually go to court, the judge will be able to grant access to however many other cases that this has also happened. You ever seen that before? Like, you're like, you get a letter in the mail
yes.
saying, hey, you know,
yes.
you got, you know, these earplugs were bad. You
yeah.
want to join our lawsuit? Things like that will go out. So we'll start
right.
getting more and more and more of these cases that will come out. So the more that piles up, the more government pressure to say, hey, we need to get the heck out of here and let them deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
I think
and that's
be better
what
off.
I think the positive that can come from someone as prominent as Trump even trying to enter some sort of conflict with them is that maybe people will see at minimum what the actual problem is. Now, whether he brings it to the table in their lawsuit, or even if he can do that.
I mean, it's
all
he can do as a private citizen.
You know what I mean?
Right?
That's a completely different conversation, but at least people are looking at, okay, how does Facebook get their money? How does Google get their money? Why are they answering to, of all people, the WHO? Follow the money, and then you'd be surprised how much we would root out, because in some cases, in a lot of cases, your taxpayer dollars are being utilized to subsidize these people. It's not through direct subsidies, and that's how they get you. It's like, okay, well, it's not technically a direct subsidy. We're just contracting them to do whatever it is that we want them to do. No, it's not a direct subsidy, but you're basically using taxpayer dollar to subsidize, or rather fund these institutions. You'd be surprised how much big tech gets from not just the American government, but from governments completely around the world, which is what got them necessarily in hot water. And you can argue that they shot themselves in the foot when they did this. So at minimal, I will say that the conflict that's happening right now between Donald Trump and them, there has to be some good that comes from it. And it might not come from the lawsuit itself.
Yeah. So can I just get confirmation, Eric, you are not going to be joining this class action lawsuit?
No, even though I say this as a person that's suspended from Twitter.
I know, that's what I'm saying.
I'm not getting in on that.
All right. Well, darn it. We've got more to come. First, we want to thank our sponsor, Omega XL. So if you are someone who you just live in constant pain, maybe it's shoulder pain, maybe it's neck pain, maybe you've just reached the age like I have where you just wake up in the morning and you're like, ow, I pulled something from sleeping. What you may not know is that the underlying cause of all of this pain that you have is likely inflammation. And unless you defeat the inflammation, you're going to keep having the pain, and it can also cause permanent damage. Now, Omega XL is backed by 35 years of clinical research, and it actually attacks the inflammation that is causing your pain. So it's not going to be like one of those pain relievers that you rub on, you know, the creams that you rub on, and it feels awesome for 10 minutes, and then you're in pain again. All right. Omega XL neutralizes that inflammation that causes the painful stiff joints and muscles. And by the way, it is natural, which I know some of you out there may be snubbing your nose at and saying, if it's natural, it must not work. But it is from it's a powerful essential fatty acid combination from the waters of New Zealand. And our very own Pat Gray, who is not what you would call a naturopath, he was in constant pain in his shoulder. He used it. The first week, he started feeling vastly better. By the second week, he was way better, 100% better. So you know what? Sometimes you got to go the natural route, and it works. Let's get you started. Order Omega XL now. Get a second bottle for free at omegaxl.com/news. That is omegaxl.com/news. New York Governor Andrew Cuomo yesterday announced the issuance of an executive order declaring a disaster emergency on the matter of gun violence. Here are a couple of his tweets from yesterday. He said, today I'm issuing an executive order declaring a disaster emergency on gun violence. Gun violence is a public health crisis, and we must treat it like one. This declaration will allow us to give this crisis the full attention and resources it deserves. Combating gun violence means getting illegal guns off the streets. 74% of guns used in crimes in New York State were purchased out of state. The New York police will form a new gun trafficking, interdiction? Unit to stop the flood of illegal guns coming into New York from states with weak gun laws. And it's interesting because I feel like, if the guns are already illegal, I don't know how you're gonna like stop that. Maybe make new laws.
That works every time.
Then that will be double illegal. And then you really don't wanna mess with something when it's double illegal. So that definitely will solve the problem. But so now they've got an executive order. It is now an emergency on gun violence. And of course the answer is more laws. More executive orders.
We saw this coming, and I think a lot of people in this network agreed that the situation at the border was a state of emergency.
I knew you were going to bring this up.
You knew I was going there, huh?
Yes, yes.
We all agreed it's an emergency. Mm-hmm. It's a state of emergency. Mm-hmm. Should we declare it that as such? I was not in agreement with that.
Under Trump.
Under Trump.
Under President Trump, when that came out.
Even though I agreed with all of his actions he was doing down there, I did not want to open that Pandora's box because you knew the left was doing this. They could not wait because they knew the next time they got power, everything was going to be declared a state of emergency. Guns are being declared a state of emergency. Cuomo's leading the way with that. What does that allow him to do? A lot of things.
Yeah.
I was reading through some of this earlier, but you know, seizing guns that he claimed illegal. I mean, I don't even know, like, because they have the wrong kind of magazine in them or something like that. Like, who the heck knows? It's probably vague on purpose. Mm-hmm. But they're just going to start going and seizing guns. He's talking about 74% or whatever it was came across state lines. Again, vague.
Yeah.
What does that mean? Was it guns that, you know, go against their assault weapons ban or whatever else? If you live in New York City, any gun is illegal, pretty much. He talked about getting rid of dangerous people from having guns. Well, basically in New York,
what's
that means everyone that they deem as dangerous.
Right.
Political ideology, does that mean? What does that mean?
Like, well, you are an extremist if you believe in conservative values.
You know how many extremist lists I'm probably on? It's probably scary. Eric even more. He probably puts me to shame. Like, this stuff is getting very, very scary, and it goes beyond that. It goes to, you know, right now, what else is going to be declared a state of emergency? And anything that they get frustrated at and stonewalled in Congress, they're going to declare it a state of emergency. Our infrastructure, is that a state of emergency? Climate change, does it become a state of emergency? It's coming.
I don't disagree with you, but I would just ask, do you not think that the left would have done that anyway? Because I mean, they don't play fair, right? So what would stop them from doing it anyway?
So they've definitely changed strategy and tactics over the last couple of years. Mm-hmm. They were very content with rhinos and non-conservatives within the Republican Party slowly pulling the rest of the country towards the left. It was a very gradual thing. Yeah. They didn't want to do it the way they're doing it now. Right. They didn't want to. I really think things started changing under Obama. He made some massive, massive changes to really polarize and, you know, divide the country. We've gone on that trajectory ever since to where now they're never going to agree. McConnell just said the other day on infrastructure, he was like, the days of bipartisanship are over. They are. Like, there are two different parts of the country right now. You know, you're either the far left or what they consider the far right. The people in the center are very hard to find anymore. Mm-hmm. Everyone is pretty much going. And at this point, I think people are just going to either side because they've picked a side and they just don't want to lose.
Yeah.
You know, they might, the people in the center that don't even really exist anymore, they're like, well, screw it. I'm just going over with these guys. There's a lot of people that now are probably very, very pro-Trump people just because they got sick of seeing the man get beat up on for four straight years. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was not a huge Trump guy, but then at the end, I was like, well, screw it. I'll go to, you know, I'll go to war with the guy because I hate a bully and they're being a bully against him.
Yeah. Eric.
Yeah, I think more of the COVID stuff is the biggest kind of part of this, which was what I feared. Certainly out of this, where you had executive actions, not just done by basically by way of the federal government, but by way of the state and local government. And he even references that. He says, this is Cuomo, he says, gun violence is a major civil rights issue today. Yes, education, employment, discrimination, which you've heard this being utilized by the rhetoric of basically every politician everywhere, that now all of a sudden this is a public health a crisis. He also says gun violence is hitting black and brown communities hardest, and it's compounding the damage from COVID. And he also said, basically, we beat COVID, we can beat this. So that's what they're going to try to do, is conflate those two different deals where, okay, you gave us this power and you allowed us to do all of these things because of COVID. Well, now here's this thing, gun violence, whatever that is. It's not just a violence issue or anything like that. And this is unfortunately why these issues will never get resolved, because they don't want to address it head on. When it comes to something, definitely in these communities that are having these issues of gun rights, it's not an issue of gun rights, though that isn't a problem, but of violence, this is a cultural issue that is not going to be resolved by government. The only thing the government does is make it harder for people that have no problem following the law to get a weapon. That's the only thing that you're doing now. The people that want to get it illegally are going to do exactly that. Look no further than New York City.
But what if you do it? But what if you make it double illegal? Double illegal.
I guess it didn't work the first time. So I guess you multiply by zero, multiply two by zero. I guess you don't get the same thing. But this is a cultural issue. And it sucks because everybody skirts around talking about it because we act like it's taboo. You know what I mean? Because what happens is that you have to address then so many aspects of this culture, definitely in these black and brown communities, in which why the violence is the way that it is. They'll never admit that. They'll never concede that, because that not only will force them to look in the mirror, but these race hustlers who helped them get in office, they would have to realize how ineffective that they have been in trying to combat this, if that's something that they even care about. So what can they do? They'll just go blame the guns, which makes no sense. Like, you just blame the guns. Like, we have other areas that, again, more obviously have more people that are owning these weapons because, well, it's not as much government interaction with them that don't have the level of violence that you guys have there. I mean, definitely say this as someone that grew up not just in Dallas, but being in the country as well. Well, it wasn't nothing for everybody to own a gun.
Right.
With nobody shooting each other up. It's almost as if it's a cultural issue. But to your point, when you talk about the we've now declared this as some crisis, and now we have the power, I would point more towards COVID. If anything else, that should be, they're even calling racism. Racism is a public health crisis, and then they get to build policies based upon that. That, if anything, should scare everyone. But the issue obviously is not going to get solved because they're still skirting around the problem.
I also love that, I mean, from Cuomo, it's rich to hear him say, if you can beat COVID, we beat COVID. Yeah. I'm like, you killed a bunch of old people in nursing homes. I don't think you're the one. Yeah, I don't think you're the one to be saying you beat COVID, Andrew. All right, we've got more to come. First, we want to thank our sponsor, StartMail. So data breaches are at an all-time high. I don't know if you guys know this, as hackers become more advanced in their cybersecurity attacks. Email poses the highest risk to identity theft, credit card fraud, among a bunch of other life-altering scams. You don't realize it when you're using all of these big-name emails. You think that it is protected, but it's not. And just one data breach could change your whole life. That is why we use StartMail here. StartMail keeps your email private, period. Every email can be encrypted or protected with a password, so big tech cannot read, scan, analyze, or sell your personal information ever. And by the way, once you delete an email, it is gone forever. All right. StartMail is backed by the world's most robust and most robust privacy laws. And by the way, they use their own servers. So it's not like they're using Amazon servers where they can just be pulled at any time, like what happened with Parler. They have got it locked down. You also get unlimited anonymous alias addresses. So if you need to provide an email to a company, but you want to protect your identity, StartMail can generate a shareable alias email, and those can be deleted at any time as well. You got to start securing your email privacy. Sign up for StartMail today. You will get 50% off of your first year if you go to startmail.com/Y. That is StartMail, StartMail.com/Y for 50% off your first year.
The second largest defense contractor in America, Raytheon, is imposing an anti-racism program using critical race theory, arguing that white or straight or Christian men should identify their privilege, participate in reparations, and of course, obviously, decolonize their bookshelves. This is a program called Stronger Together. And by the way, Chris Rufo, who has been amazing on critical race theory, he is the one who uncovered all of this. He obtained these documents and videos from a whistleblower. So let's go through some of these pages of the guide. So here is the one of the front pages. Commitment to diversity and inclusion takes all of us. CEO Action was founded on a shared belief that diversity, equity, and inclusion is a societal issue, not a competitive one, and that collaboration and bold action from the business community, especially CEOs, is vital to driving change at scale. Let's go through some of this. So the CEO had all of these employees, all of the employees sign this pledge. It says, I pledge to check my bias, speak up for others, and show up for all. I will initiate meaningful, complex, and sometimes difficult conversations with my friends and colleagues. I will ask myself, do my actions and words reflect the value of inclusion? I will move outside my comfort zone. I mean, it is all incredible critical race theory BS. Here's some more. It is a chart, what not to say to your black colleagues right now, and instead what to say. So there's one that says, I'm scared to say the wrong thing to you. Well, don't say that. Don't say that to your black colleague. Don't say, I hope slash pray things change soon. And also don't say, I can't wait for things to calm down and get back to normal, because that actually says that your comfort is more important than the message of anti-racism. So check your privilege, okay? And then this is my actual favorite. This here is from the guide. It says for white people to find and join a local white space to learn more and talk about conscious and unconscious biases us white folks have. If there's not one in your area, start one. I feel like in the past, historically, they did that. It didn't go so well. I think they had meetings. I think they wore hoods with the little pointy hats. I don't think that that ends well. I thought that that was like why we had the whole like MLK civil rights movement. I thought that that was where we were going with that, but apparently not. We're just back to find and join your local white space. So I don't want you to whitesplain to Eric. So I want Eric to please go first. Eric,
I didn't want to because I was scared of what to say to
you. Right. Well, let me pull up. Let's pull up what not to say and what to say. Can we pull that up? Okay, Eric. I'm having conversations about racism with my non-black family and friends, even though I'm afraid.
This is unbelievable, but it actually is believable when you consider, obviously, it's the biggest defense contractor of the United States government. A lot of those contracts are going to be, considering where your government, I mean, it's going
all
the way.
Yeah, look at what the armies.
Armies, all the alphabet, all of them are doing that. Obviously, they're going to tie that money to who can signal the hardest, and then you'll get the contract. Yep. This isn't, that was anticipated, definitely considering that Raytheon almost exclusively is funded by way, certainly, of the state. And that little pledge there, Obviously, I believe that a lot of people are going to sign it having not even read half of crap in there. And be like, all right,
it's
whatever.
The terms and conditions.
Yeah, conditions. Like, I'll accept it. No, I'll probably just sign my life off. Who cares? I don't even crap about that. But it's just such weird language. You know what I mean? Dude? To sit up and see that manifest itself, yes, in these private institutions. But it's not unexpected, scary maybe, but it isn't certainly unexpected because, again, the money is tied to the state, so they have to play ball, and that's what they're going to do. This is a bizarre subject matter to even converse about. The fact that they're really encouraging people to, to have these conversations with their colleagues. I know when I was doing just regular private sector jobs, the last thing I was trying to talk about to my colleagues about any damn thing regarding racial bias or whatever bull crap. Did that thing say, though? It was the first thing you read. They said white, Christian, and straight. Did it say or did it say and?
It said or, I believe.
So that means, guys,
let me pull this back out.
They do say that the black people, black straight people, black straight men are the white people of black people. So maybe
it says arguing that white or straight or Christian.
All right,
men.
Yeah. So that's not just white folk. That's
right.
A whole large swaths of people that they and that's ultimately what this boils down to anyway. The concept of not just critical race theory, but Marxism certainly in general. Look, this is your taxpayer dollars going to subsidize that crap. So if you want to look any further than why government bad, there you go.
Can I, Jason, I want to get your thoughts, but let me bring up Chris Rufo, tweet number 5, because this is great. It says, Raytheon tells employees to, quote, identify everyone's race during workplace conversations.
Like, hey, I'm black.
I really thought this is what we fought against.
When you gather
the
around the water cooler, like every time?
Yeah, like, identify everyone's
American,
race.
I'm black, Eric. I'm white, Jason. Did you catch the game last night?
What the? This is goofy, but we're laughing because it is goofy.
It's so
America.
Stupid.
It's goofy.
It's so stupid. It says, again, with that, it says whites must listen to the experiences of marginalized identities and should give those with such identities the floor in meetings or on calls, even if that means silencing yourself, Jason. I will let you talk now.
Thank you. It's such a backward way of thinking. You talk about the disconnect between the two sides in America right now. Like, so our stance, everyone at the table is, when you talk to someone, you don't see race.
Yeah, you see them as an individual first and foremost. That's what
right.
it is.
That is the true anti-racism.
Yeah. Right. Like, I'm not defined by this, right. I'm an individual.
Exactly. Right. But content of character, right? Yeah. Like, that used to be...
We're so far from that.
But that used to be like a left-leaning talking point, right? At some point it changed, and then now we have to view every single person under what subcategory they are.
Yeah.
I remember when Biden had that speech the other day where it was, you can't define an American.
Yes.
And so what he was saying was, you can't, because I got what his root point was, that we're all the same.
Right.
But that's not what they believe.
Yeah.
Like, he was saying that, I don't know why, but just to score points or whatever. But they don't believe that. They want to, like, so I was reading through some of these documents from Raytheon, and this is the same across the board for all companies right now. If you want to get a high ESG score, and that way you get the funding, you get the financial investment from people. If you get a high ESG score, they require a certain part, a report from you that says, how many Indians do you have? How many Asians do you have? How many black people do you have? How many white people do you have? They categorize everyone down the board. I don't know why. Like, I don't know what they're doing with that information. I don't know if it's eventually, like, if some of the investors, the people holding, writing the checks go, oh my gosh, they just dipped below, 6 Asians, better get that back up. Like, what? Like, it makes sense. But you were exactly right. This is, I don't believe Raytheon believes in the CRT crap.
Wow.
Not at all. They care about making money and blowing crap up.
Yeah.
That's all they care about.
I don't know this for a fact,
and that's
but
the funny
I can almost
thing.
Guarantee
y'all seen
you
the memes,
the
like the memes with the, like, Raytheon bombs and all that sort of stuff, and it'll be like, when Trump was president this, or when Biden was president, it's the same damn bomb, but it has, like, all sort of, like, LGBT rainbows all over it. That's basically what we're getting right now. You're doing the same crap, but I guess you're signaling,
Right.
Your weapons are being used to, I don't know, hurt brown people across the on the other side of the world.
Look at the contracts. They'll do contracts in Saudi Arabia and have no issue whatsoever. Yeah. They won't even mention their CRT stuff about how equitable they are.
Can I just the CEO is apparently Gregory Hayes, who is like extremely white and makes $13.4 million a year. So white guy. Fighting against himself, I guess. I mean, I would think that if he really believed in this, he would step down as CEO and give the position to a black person.
Notice the folks that lecture the most about it, they'll never give up their power. The people below them, they'll play musical chairs, do whatever.
Give up your money. Give up any of that.
Would they do that? Mm-hmm. Absolutely not, because everything is about a signal to them. Because he's not going to take a pay cut, is he? How about you give half of your, what is it, $13 million? How did you just give half of it to, I don't know, some black executive? Or hire a black executive.
You don't need $13 million. That's what the left would say. Yeah. You don't need all that money.
Oh my
give
God.
Half of it. Yeah. Why not?
That's what he won't do, though. No. But then, look, man, this is a crazy conversation to have, but ultimately, when it comes to the authoritarian left, this is what they prioritize. It's a very collectivist way of viewing the world, but I am an individual, first and foremost. I have no problem with people acknowledging the fact that, I got a lot of melanin in my skin. That's fine. But I am an individual, first and foremost, and I always say all skin folk ain't kin folk. But that's the way that they see it. It's like, well, you're black, therefore the experience is the same. Or you're white. You're white. Your experience is the same. You're a woman. Your experience is the same, and we need to work together to do this and that. It's like, no, dude, we're individuals. How about see me like that, first and foremost?
Yeah. All right, we have got more to come, including Joe Biden botching yet another thing, this time in Afghanistan, when we come back.
Yeah, so under CRT, is it just if you were
born? The United States apparently left Afghanistan's Bagram airfield after nearly 20 years by shutting off the electricity and slipping away in the night without notifying the base's new Afghan commander, who, by the way, only discovered the Americans' departure more than 2 hours after they left. This is coming from the Afghan military. Jason, you are, of course, our military guy here, our in-house military expert. Can you kind of give us the lowdown on this story? Because this seems crazy.
Yeah. So a lot of people surrounding the president have said that a lot of the things he's doing now regarding Afghanistan is based off of a, quote, gut instinct. So a lot of things he's doing.
Joe Biden's gut instinct?
Or
whoever's pulling the strings gut instinct?
That's a good question. Who's really pulling the, I don't know. Who's really in charge over there? I do not know. You're Raytheon?
Yeah.
I think the reason they snuck out in the middle of the night was because they didn't want the media fiasco, because they knew that they'd get a lot of people in the media coming out there and they'd be putting a big spotlight on the fact that we're abandoning a base. A base that will probably go to the Taliban. Look, I'm going to be conservative with my
But they didn't even tell the Afghan military.
Yeah, they don't care. They don't care. They really don't. This is a hard one for me because I have a lot of emotional attachment to it. It really sucks to just hand this back over to the people that we fought. And mark my words, I'm gonna be conservative. I'll give them at maximum 12 months. It's somewhere between 6 and 12 months, the Taliban will be back in control of that country. Mm. I'm almost convinced that's what's going to happen. They're already doing a massive assault. They're taking more and more territory. It's going to happen. Look, I'm not advocating for us staying there. The war in Afghanistan is now old enough to vote, over the age to vote right now. So it's absolutely insane. We should not be there. We are going to have to deal with the same stuff. The Taliban is going to be back in control, and they are going to do the same crap. They're going to be training terrorists. They're going to be doing all kinds of stuff. What do we do about
that?
It's not our responsibility to patrol that anymore. I think our boys need to get out of there. I agreed with it when Trump said that we need to do that, and I agreed it when Biden just piggybacked off of what Trump was already going to do, and somehow he's going to take credit for it. But he's also going to take credit for the fallout, which is going to happen in his administration. Question now is, what's going to happen? Are the Chinese going to fill the void, which they probably will? They're already signaling they will. Russians are saying they might do something. They're all chomping at the bit right now to try and take advantage and make us look bad on the international stage. My thing to say to them is, go for it. Russia, you already did it once. Do it again and fail. China, do it. You want to go ahead? Do it and enter in the same quagmire. No other
no other country is ever going to rule that area. They're just not. It's never happened since the Mongols, and before them, it's never happened. So it's just, it's hubris to think that we can go there and somehow enact a different, you know, ending. It's not going to happen. We need to get out. But the hard truth right now, I guess my wrapping up of all this is, we have to come to grips with what's about to happen. It's, I'm not saying we're going to get attacked, but they are going to be doing the same things that they did before. The question is, how are we going to react to it? Are we going to enter into more never-ending wars? Are we going to show more restraint, let other people take care of this? We're going to have to deal with it somehow, but I'm making a prediction. 6 to 12 months, this reality is going to be in our face.
Eric.
Look, that's the reality of the situation. You put it correctly. Obviously, my position, I'm a libertarian here. I want them the hell out. I've been wanting them the hell out. I've been calling for them to get the hell out since I was loud enough to tell them to get the hell up out of there, because it's a war that they simply cannot win. And obviously, I'm not a big fan of war in general. But you, like you mentioned, is it our job to be playing world police? And this is the unfortunate thing about this conversation when it comes to us occupying, or rather the United States government occupying in any way, shape, or form the Middle East. It's that we look at what will happen or may happen, and we look at that as if it's our duty, because we're the leader of the free world, our duty to try to save them, sometimes from themselves, albeit, but save that or liberate that area. Now, we don't necessarily see a lot of success in that regards, but considering that region, it's something that we have to face as a reality. And to think that it's, be it a lot of you people's upcoming sons and daughters that are going to be flown, or sons are going to be flown over there to have to deal with that. And so, unfortunately, some of them lose their lives. I guess we have to decide, is that worth the absolute trade-off? But I don't think that. Mm. You know, I would believe that we'd rather be trying to, considering all the issues that we have in our own country, utilizing those economics to resolve those problems, as opposed to spending billions upon billions, we're at trillions now, of dollars that we've spent trying to liberate whoever's over there, certainly in Afghanistan. That's a reality. So, yes, you're right, and I'm glad that you're being upfront with it. Yes, we need to. I want us to get out, and I agree with you. But, yeah, you're right. It's not going to resolve itself. And there, unfortunately, are a lot of libertarians, even that would agree with to get up out of there. But they are, I think, being oblivious to the idea that, well, that just means that everything, every problem that basically exists in that area is going to go away. No, it's not. No, it's not. And that's a reality that we have to absolutely acknowledge. It's not about whether it's going to be a problem out there. It's more of, is it our job, and should we be exhausting resources to considering everything that's going on in our own country? Should we be exhausting those resources to try to deal with the issues that are happening right now in Afghanistan? And it took 20 years for people to come to terms with, maybe, no, that's not what we should be doing.
Yeah. I
will say, just to, yeah, to wrap it up, is I think, just to circle back to the closing of the airbase in the middle of the night, I think is very symbolic for how Biden is going to approach Afghanistan for the rest of his, you know, tenure.
Yeah.
He's going to try to hide from the fallback, which I guess I could go on all day on this.
Oh my gosh, I said real quick, we gotta take a break. We'll be back.
I saw you give me that look. I saw it. I was like,
Hey, this is the part where I tell all of you, if you have not yet gone to wherever you get your audio podcasts, you got to subscribe, rate, and review The News and Why It Matters. But what I really want to focus on for just a second is that both of the gentlemen that are here in these chairs are actually on the new podcast cover.
Yeah.
You guys are both on this. There's Eric at the top. There's Jason down there at the bottom.
With your face. With your hand on my face.
My hand is kind of covering
your
face.
Did that on purpose.
We got to protect the viewers. We don't want to scare them away, Jason. We don't want to scare them away. If you review the show, give us a nice review, you may see yours read on air, like the one today from Intermatrix Knot, who says, 5 stars, great and fun to listen to. I can always count on Sarah to have awesome guests and look forward to hearing their input. Thank you for that. We've got one more from Josmy15. Love this show. They bring an independent, in-depth look at real issues. So thank you guys so much for your reviews. We're loving them. Keep them coming. By the way, don't forget to subscribe to Young Ripa 5'9 over here. Yeah. Young Ripa 5'9 is his YouTube, so make sure to go look it up. I know people are like, where's Eric Jalai? I can't find him. That's where he is. Go subscribe.